Today we're thinking about suffering. It's a big topic. Thanks for joining me. I'm Jeff Gerson. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button and that like button. I read from Mark 8, verse 31 to 38. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said this plainly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you're not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of people, things of man." And he called to him the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his life? For what can a man give in return for his life? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is God's word to us today. Let's pray. Father, it is beyond belief that your plan not only includes suffering, but actually embraces it. That your Son should deny himself, take our suffering upon himself, and die our death before rising again. We pray that we might not flee from cross-shaped pain. Instead, may we give our lives in costly service. May we embrace the shame of you and your words. And in so doing, gain our souls, we pray, for your glory alone. Amen. I sighed in my soul. It was the kind of sigh that comes up from the very depths, deep inside of you. It was a sigh of powerlessness, even a sigh of despair. If only things were different. If only things were not as they are. If only. On the day of this particular sigh, I was praying for Equatorial Guinea. It's a tiny rump of land up the west coast of Africa, just before you get to Cameroon and Nigeria. It's about a quarter the size of the Western Cape. This is what Wikipedia says about Equatorial Guinea. Its government is authoritarian. It has one of the worst human rights records in the world, consistently ranking amongst the worst of the worst. But, according to the World Bank, Equatorial Guinea has the highest gross national income per capita of any African country, largely as a result of large oil deposits. And yet, despite its impressive income, Equatorial Guinea is plagued by extreme poverty, with 70% of the population living on less than $1 a day. 8% of children die before the age of 5, and more than half of the population lacks basic, clean drinking water. Its authoritarian president, Teodoro Obiang, is Africa's second longest-serving dictator, who's widely suspected of using the country's oil wealth to enrich himself and his associates. In 2006, Forbes estimated his personal wealth to be somewhere around $600 million. I suppose that I shouldn't have been surprised at Equatorial Guinea's story, because it is just so, well, so normal in our world. Leaders whose thinking is so inwards and so focused on themselves that they consider their nation's resources to be their own personal piggy bank. Leaders who are so mentally delusional that they consider themselves to be held to another standard than everyone else. Leaders who consider it their birthright to be pampered and adored and to do simply as they please. Nkandla cost 246 million rand. That's the equivalent of nearly 1,000 RDP houses. That's to say that there are 1,000 families in our country that do not have proper homes today because of the greed of one South African leader. But then, of course, it's so easy, isn't it, to point fingers at corrupt, self-absorbed politicians. It is, of course, even a national sport in our country. Painfully today, the Bible wants us to turn the attention to our own hearts and for us to ask ourselves today, are we actually any better? Do people sigh about us? Are we like them? Or are we different? Today, we're in the Bible book called Mark for one last time this year. It's about two-thirds of the way in your Bible, and Mark is an eyewitness account of the life of Jesus. Today, Mark describes Jesus in a way that is extraordinary. He's so radical in what he says that he makes the word radical look tame. Jesus is peculiar, surprising, challenging, even confrontational. And yet he's also strangely appealing, so different to what we used to. Today, Jesus issues a challenge that resounds and resonates across the centuries. And he does that not simply in his words, but by his own very life. He issues a personal challenge today. It's a challenge to you. It's a challenge to me. It's a challenge to every human that will ever live. Let's listen in on a little conflict that takes place between Jesus and Peter. Come. If you will, read with me. How about we read together? How about you read it aloud as you watch me? Just one verse. I'll put it up on the screen. Mark 8, verse 31 says, "He began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days, rise again." Jesus is speaking to his 12 disciples. It's an important moment. They've just realized that he is the Messiah King that was promised right throughout the Old Testament. It's just dawned on them, and Peter, as their spokesman, has blurted it out for all to hear. He says, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." The nation of Israel had been waiting for centuries for a Messiah to come and save them. And this insignificant little group of nobodies realizes that their friend Jesus is him. They have hit the historical jackpot. Everyone has been waiting for this person, and he's their friend. I mean, it's like realizing that Justin Bieber sat next to you at high school. You shared lunch with him. The Messiah is here. It's Jesus, and they know him. Now, as soon as they recognize this important fact, Jesus begins to teach them that he's not the kind of king that they might have hoped for. He is, in fact, a king that purposefully and intentionally turns his face towards suffering. He's a king who will choose to walk into the eye of the pain of the world. He'll personally select pain. He'll embrace suffering out of personal choice. He's a king whose subjects will hate him and discard him and scorn him because of his own choice. He's a king who will be killed by his own subject. He's a king who will rule naked and exposed on a cross. He'll be rejected. He'll be murdered. And this will all take place because he chooses it. And then after that has happened, he'll rise again. Look at verse 32. Jesus said this plainly, that is boldly, clearly, confidently. No wonder Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, Jesus rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you're not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of the world, the things of man." Peter's just so lovely, isn't he? So human, so foot in the mouth, normal, just like us. Peter, so speak before you think, so like me, and I suspect perhaps a bit like you too. What you thinking, Jesus? Stop the suffering drivel. You're the king, man. You're the king. Palaces and wealth and bling and power and Swiss bank accounts. That's what kings do. Not in God's kingdom. Not God, says Jesus. And definitely not me. That's what the world does. That's not what God does. That's not what God is. No, God suffers. God serves. God dies. God rules from the throne of pain. God gives. God stoops. God chooses to be rejected. God suffers. God dies. I have immense respect for Queen Elizabeth II. She conducted herself with such great dignity and serenity for 70 years. She deserves to be honored for her reign. But as I watched her funeral, I did wonder what the world might be like if she had been a queen like this. There were a couple of glimpses of it, but not much. The Washington Post estimates the Queen's assets at about £500 million. The royalty's assets at about, well, £19 billion. She makes the ruler of Equatorial Guinea look like a pauper. Bill Gates recently announced his desire to give away most of his fortune in his lifetime. I have no particular affection for Bill Gates, but that's exactly what Jesus did. He doesn't keep. He doesn't store. He gives, and he suffers, and he serves, and he dies. He embraces humanity, and he enters our world. So much does he embrace our humanness that he even embraces our pain and our suffering and our death in order to give us life. Perhaps the greatest objection to God flung out by Western philosophy, as if it's a knockout blow that no one has ever thought of, is the problem of pain and suffering in this world. It's a real problem, isn't it? Our world screams, perhaps you scream, why doesn't God do something about this particular suffering? Why did God allow my tragedy to happen? Why am I suffering so? If he's supposed to be so good and so big, why is my pain so large? David Attenborough famously articulated it when he said, I think of a little boy sitting on the bank of a river in West Africa with a worm that's boring through his eyeball and which will almost certainly turn him blind within a few years. And now this God, whom you say created every single species, must presumably have created that worm too. I don't find that compatible with the notion of God being a merciful creator God, end quote. Well, here's God's reply. Here's God's answer to David Attenborough. His answer is himself. He walks into the pain of the world to embrace it, to suffer it himself. He voluntarily takes it. He lets the worm make him blind. God personally chooses the pain, absorbs it, and grips it. He dies, and that is the God of this world. That's kapow, isn't it? Staggering. God is not distant, capricious, a meanie, viciously raining down suffering on those that don't do his bidding. And the very opposite. He comes into it all, and he comes to take it to himself. He comes to die in our place. I'm personally drawn to that sort of heroism. I'm drawn to a king like that. I'm drawn to a leader like that. I'm drawn to a God like that. Until shockingly he says, you must do the same. We must die on a cross too. Mark 8:34, and calling the crowd to him with his disciples, Jesus said to them, if anyone would come after me, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever would save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a person to gain the whole world and yet forfeit their soul? What can a person give in return for their soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him, of them, of that person, will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Jesus calls the crowd to listen. Notice that it's the crowd now, not the disciples, which is to say that Jesus is speaking directly to everyone. He's speaking to us. He's speaking to you. He's speaking to me. He says that if we would follow him, then our following of him will be like him. It will be cross-shaped. Let's not romanticize the cross. Today, we polish it up and attach it to churches and bishops. We hang it around our necks and fashioned in gold and platinum. We tattoo it on our arms, on our biceps, on our wrists. We wear it as earrings and we draw it on our wrist strapping when we play rugby. In the first century, it was not an ornament. The cross, well, it was an obscenity, an odious and grotesque expression of all that was horrible. For us to bear our cross is to suffer a kind of a minor inconvenience, like, giving up Facebook or chocolate for Lent. For us to bear our cross is to suffer the minor irritant of a grumpy in-law or a runny nose. But the cross is none of those petty things. It is an extreme repugnance. It's a lethal injection, a public flogging, an instrument of terror, the death penalty. The cross is an execution device of such cruelty and shame and humiliation that it was reserved for only the very worst of the worst. The cross so dehumanized its victims that no Roman citizen could be crucified without express consent from the emperor. In 71 BC, after a battle, the Roman general Crassus crucified 6,000 of his enemies on the Appian Way. A century later, when Mark was writing these words, Nero was crucifying Christians, the Christians who were reading them. He was covering them in tar and setting them alight to illuminate his palace grounds, declaring them to be enemies of the state. Jesus says that he's the Messiah King, and that he, the Messiah King, will choose that sort of death. He will choose a life filled with adversity and pain, and shockingly, he says, that is what following him looks like. To come after Jesus is to become like Jesus. It is to embrace a life of self-denial for the sake of others. It will be a life lived in dramatic contrast to the life that the world anticipates, expects, and even demands. It will be a reversal. It will be a life of loss and of giving and of serving. It will be a life of others, not a life of me. And it will be a life so unashamed of the suffering of our King that like him, we too will choose it. Now, I'm not so sure that I want this. How do you feel? Jesus, that's a bit extreme, isn't it? What about going halfway? What about a little bit of suffering, but not too much? I'll make some sacrifices. I'm happy to do something, but to the point of death? It just seems a bit over the top, don't you think? Try that with your spouse. Try it with your children, or try it with your boss. Do you mind if we have half a marriage? We'll be married on the weekend, but not on Monday to Friday. That's a bit extreme to be married all 7 days. Or with your boss, I'll work for you a few days a week, and then I'll work for the opposition on the other days. Will that be okay? Or with your children, I'll be your parent on 3 days a week, all week. Oh, that's a bit much. No, relationships don't work like that. We commit. For richer, for poorer, for better, for worse, in sickness and in health, till death do us part. We can't be half with Jesus. It is very much the desire of our day to have the advantages of being Christian, but none of the costs. I call it Christianity-like light. It's like castle light or your favorite beer light, all the advantages of beer, but a less of the costs. We want to live in Claremont and to live for ourselves and to keep all our money for ourselves and then when we get to heaven, to have all the blessings of heaven for ourselves too. Jesus, it can't be done. His disciples, well, they choose to follow a God of suffering and they choose a life of suffering too. The claim of Christ on us is total, all of us, every compartment. Jesus' claim doesn't allow us a convenient compartmentalization of religion and work, of secular and sacred, of natural and spiritual. It is all, always, or it is nothing. And so God asks us today, are we in with him? Will we die? Will we serve? Will we give as our God gave? If your following of Jesus is costing you nothing today, then it is worth nothing. If you're not giving anything to God, then you do not love God, no matter what you may say, no matter what you may profess in your thoughts. That's the truth. If you will not embrace deep, personal, radical change, you're probably not a Christian. If you'll not embrace relational cost for Jesus, then your faith is worth nothing. If your faith doesn't cost you money, then it's not worth anything. Following Jesus must cost us money. Money given to the poor, money given to gospel ministry, money given to those in need. If we're not serving with our time, with our effort, then our faith is worth nothing. Following Jesus must make you tired. That is what effort is. It makes you tired. It takes energy and time and thought and choice. It requires giving time to do what I don't want to do. Like taking a meal to a single mom. That takes effort. As a single person, inviting people into your home, that takes effort. Arranging flowers in the church or taking them to people to enjoy, that takes effort. Being a happy welcomer when you're an introvert, that takes effort. Giving up a Saturday for the spring fair, well, that requires effort. Wasn't our spring fair just magnificent? And giving away 15% of your income has a personal cost attached to it. Or budgeting carefully so that I can actually give something takes effort and cost. Choosing love and joy in a world of grumbling and selfishness, well, that takes effort. Working at patience and adding self-control to our tongues, that takes lots of effort. Serving your life group by pitching up prepared and then engaging with them so that you can pray for them, well, that takes effort. Coming to church when I'm tired and frankly, I'd much rather stay in bed. It takes effort. If you've never embraced any suffering for Jesus, ask yourself, is it because I've never embraced Jesus, the suffering King? But then, in a stark and dramatic paradox, an unexpected paradox that we do not anticipate, Jesus promises us that this cross-shaped life is a life of joy, a life of eternal gain. To stand with Jesus is to lose your life in this world for something worth dying for. It is to lose your life for the sake of God and the gospel, and that is to gain your soul. So that on that day when Jesus returns, on that day when he once again places his foot on the soil of our world, on that day when Jesus arrives, when Bitcoin will be worthless and dollars meaningless, on that day when all of creation holds its breath, as Jesus is revealed and seen, on that day, he will acknowledge those that have stood with him. Jesus will say, "Sipo, come over here. Everyone, did you see what he did? He stood for me. He suffered for me. He gave himself for me." Imagine that day. The heavenly court is watching. Every person that has ever lived, the great, the mighty, the noble, the angelic courts in all their glory are watching. And Jesus walks over to you, puts his arm around you and says to the entire universe, "I'm so proud of her. She's with me. He's with me. They're mine." There is a God. What a God he is. Not like the kings of this world. He's gentle. He dies for his people. As God calls us who follow him to be like him, the suffering God, the serving God, and his suffering, serving people. Let's pray. Oh Lord, what a challenge to us. What an extraordinary vision we're given of you, who you really are. We pray for ourselves that we would not be pathetic, but rather embrace the way of the cross, embrace Jesus, embrace suffering, we pray, for Jesus' sake.